Did the CIA kill President Kennedy? There's a member of the CIA at the time of President Kennedy's death that believes such and also believes it's directly impacting President Obama, who's afraid the same thing could happen to him. We're going to look at that and much more during this program. Be sure you stay tuned. I'm Larry Rice, and this is Here's Help. During this program, I'm going to be talking to Ray McGovern. He was a CIA agent at the time that President Kennedy was killed. And you have indicated in previous conversations with me that you believe, and I've had this wonder, because I saw the Bay of Pigs embarrass the CIA, okay? Mm. We saw so many things that started taking place, you know, that started happening. There were so many, why did they have the bubble down on the car that particular day? Mm-hmm. So many things that just kind of began to happen. You're going to wonder, was the CIA involved? And you were a member of the CIA, and you're convinced the CIA was involved in killing President Kennedy?
I am.
Tell us why.
Well, you mentioned it. It's very perceptive. You went back to the Bay of Pigs, mm-hmm. and really that's where it started. You'll recall Kennedy came into office. He was very green, mm-hmm. and he was told, oh, the CIA has this plan to overthrow Castro, and Eisenhower has approved it. He did, sort of, you know. Mm-hmm. And we have this band of emigres. They're going to land on the Bay of Pigs beach, and the Cubans are just going to fold and get rid of Castro, and we'll, you know. Now, that was not very credible, but Kennedy was green, and they didn't want to seem soft on Castro. I mean, you know, that's the worst sin. So he said, all right, well, I'll go along with that, but it doesn't seem very promising to me. I don't know if the Cubans are that dissatisfied with Castro, But I'll do it on one condition, and that is that no U.S. armed forces are to be used. I'm not going to send in the army. I'm not going to help you out at the airport. We're not going to do that, okay? So those are the terms. And so Alan Dulles, the head of the CIA, and this fellow Bissell, his chief of operations, said, oh, sure. Well, long story short, when Alan Dulles died, in his study was a coffee-stained note which said, John Kennedy will never be able to avoid committing U.S. forces once we get on the beach and get pinned down, because there's no way we can get off the beach without U.S. forces supporting us. So it's very clear that he was mousetrapping President Kennedy, saying, you know, okay, we'll land with this ragtag group of emigres, mm-hmm. but then, you know, you're going to have to help us out, even though he said he wouldn't. Now, they were surprised as hell when he made good on his promise and he said, all right, look, I said, no U.S. forces, no U.S. forces. And of course, you know what happened in the Bay of Pigs.
It's a big fiasco.
Yeah. And now, Alan Dulles was clearly the guy who arranged all this, and so he was in disgrace. Kennedy waited a decent interval of 2 months to fire him, but then he got fired. Now, when the head of the CIA, whose brother is the head of the State Department, gets fired, you know, especially a guy like Alan Dulles, you don't take that lightly. And so there was this revenge factor. And then, as I think I mentioned before, there was the whole notion that Kennedy was soft on communism. Why? Because after Cuba, when he and Khrushchev almost incinerated the world, they decided there's a better way to do things. They started talking behind the back of the CIA. You don't mm-hmm. do that either, okay? Then he was having people, journalists who were close to him, talk with Castro's people. Oh, another sin. And then there was the interim limited test ban treaty, where test ban for nuclear weapons were prohibited except underground. And the last and the crowning joy, of course, was the business where Kennedy decided to issue two executive orders to pull our troops out of Vietnam. 1,000 troops by the end of 63, okay, and the bulk of the rest of them by the end of 65. So, what further proof do you need that this guy is soft on communism? He's going to let the commies take over Southeast Asia, Indonesia, the dominoes will fall. We got to stand up for our patriotic duty, save the country from this guy. And, you know, exactly how it went down, I never was quite sure until I read JFK and the Unspeakable, a book by James Douglas, an incredible author who took advantage of the previous scholarship on this, plus the new documents released by Act of Congress, put it all together in a very convincing way. Am I convinced? I'm convinced. Is it 100%? Of course it's not 100%, but it seems incredibly likely that this happened, and a lot of the unexplained circumstances are pretty well explained in JFK and The Unspeakable.
Okay, I haven't had the privilege of reading that book. I've, you know, heard who killed Kennedy, and that touches on some of that, but it leaves an awful lot of questions. For example, as you know, why was the bubble top down that particular day? Oswald, did he act all alone? You know, Jack Ruby, where did he come from? And all these things come together yet. Why do you feel the Warren Report issued what it did then?
Well, do you know who the chief of staff for the Warren Commission was?
Who's that?
Alan Dulles.
Oh, okay, that's explained. So that's how they got him.
I mean, it's unbelievable. He still had a measure of respect in establishment Washington, and so he volunteered to be the chief of staff of the commission, and he picked the ones that could testify and the ones that wouldn't testify, and he picked people who would cover for the agency. So it was about the worst you could, you know, worst you could get. And I often wondered, you know, this one shooter from, you know, from the top of the, I mean, that never held a weight. And you have Zapruder and other people showing that there was a guy on the grassy knoll. Well, this book goes into that in some detail. And the relevance today, really, is that I think the president came into office 5 years ago.
President Obama.
Yeah, President Obama, afraid of the CIA. He had decried torture, decried many of the other things that were going on, kidnapping and black prisons. And yet when he became president, the first thing he said was, well, we're not going to look backward, we'll only look forward. And instead of putting in somebody in the CIA who would take hold of these guys, get rid of the ones that were running the torture, he named Leon Panetta, a lawyer who would smooth things over with the Congress and the public, and leave the torturers in office. You know, I've tried to visualize what it's like. You know, you go down to lunch in the cafeteria in the building where I worked in Langley, Virginia. So, oh, there's Jose Rodriguez. He did the torturing in Thailand. Oh, yeah, he's the guy that destroyed the 96 torture tapes. Hey, Jose, how are you? You know, what's it like for those people? So those folks are still around. I always ask myself, Why would Barack Obama have that happen, and then why would he not follow through on some of these other indignities, where John Brennan, for example, who's head of the CIA now, is resisting a publication of a four-year effort costing $40 million by the Senate Intelligence Committee, which looked into the paperwork on who authorized the torture, who did it, whether it got any get any results. The answers to that is the top people in the Bush and Cheney administration, top people in the CIA. Results? No results. And this is the important point. Torture has never yielded reliable information. I mean, people can reason to, even though you watch this TV and this movies and all that stuff. When George Bush was forced to admit that what he called enhanced interrogation techniques were used, he said actually an alternative set of procedures for interrogation, that same day, the head of Army Intelligence, I feel an affinity there because I was an Army Intelligence officer, his name was John Kimmins, he was Lieutenant General, and he got up across the river at 10 o'clock, Bush did his conference at 2 o'clock, and he said, and I quote, "No reliable intelligence has ever come from harsh interrogation techniques. History shows that, and the experience of the last 5 years, hard years, also shows that." That was September 6th, 2006, 5 years, 6 minus 5, 201 when we started doing this, okay? Now, that was the gutsy thing to say, and that's the truth. I was an Army intelligence, I know that. Now, so the question is, well, if you can't get reliable information from torture, why would you do it? And there are basically two answers. Number one, because you can and it scares a lot of people. But number two, whereas torture is no good at all for reliable information, you know, if you want unreliable information, torture works like a charm. What do I mean by that? I mean, if you want to get somebody to confess that Al-Qaeda was being trained in weapons of mass destruction and explosives in Baghdad, and you can associate Baghdad with Al-Qaeda, and by inference, Baghdad with 9/11. Wow, it makes it a lot easier for you to attack Baghdad and Iraq. That was the name of the game. And there are several examples where the requirement was not to get reliable information, but to get someone, however remotely associated with Al-Qaeda, to say, oh yeah, I know all about that. And they did. They got a guy named Alibi. He was a Libyan, okay? Mm-hmm. And they got him. He said, you used to do the travel vouchers. And so will you confess that you sent all manner of operatives up to Baghdad to get trained? He said, no. Are you sure? Well, they tried everything they could, and they couldn't do it. So they sent him to the friendly Egyptian service that has more experience in these kinds of things. And guess what? Alibi confessed that that's precisely what he did. 2 days later, the President of the United States repeated that information, and 3 days after that, Congress authorized our first real war of aggression against Iraq. That's how cynical it was. What happened to Alibi? He got loose about 3 months later, and they asked him, he said, well, yeah, they were torturing me. I only said that because they wanted to stop the torture. He ends up in a Libyan prison, and guess what? When the UN people come and find out he's there, about to interview him, all of a sudden, he commits suicide. And, you know, devout Muslims don't normally commit suicide, but that got Alibi out of the picture. So Alibi is sort of a poster child for this because everyone knew that he was saying trash, but it went up to the president, and he and Cheney played it real big.
I knew numerous presidents were quite afraid of J. Edgar Hoover and how long he was in power. But you're indicating that President Obama and some of his policies are a result of fear of the CIA, that the same thing could happen to him that happened to President Kennedy, that they could take him out and make it look in such a way that it was somebody else involved?
That's right. And I have some anecdotal evidence of that.
Okay.
And this is not direct, but it's secondhand. But the firsthand fellow told me is incredibly reliable. Before the last election, Barack Obama was having a big dinner with some very well-heeled supporters. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I wasn't there. And they were pinging on him and saying, well, you're supposed to be a progressive. Why do you do this and why are you doing that and all that stuff? Finally, he got up in some high dudgeon and he said, look, he says, it's easy enough for you to criticize me, but don't you remember what happened to Dr. King? Now, we do know what happened to Dr. King. He was assassinated, and we know that the FBI had a role in that with those white guys down there in Memphis. So, you know, do I criticize him for being fearful? No. But if he was going to be that fearful, I don't think he should have run for president of the United States because that's no way to run.
I want to pick up from what you just said.
Sure.
Because I've been over many years, I've been thinking this, discussing this. James Earl Ray, I even interviewed his brother, who was part of his escape, okay? James Earl Ray escaped from Jefferson City Penitentiary. You don't just walk out of there. His brother hit him in a laundry cart and got him out. And just was portraying some of this. His brother actually lived in St. Louis. I interviewed him some years back. Mm. But I've always had strong feelings that the government was a part of getting this man out of prison, helping him escape, and then killing.
Well, you know,
how do you feel about that?
Well, it's clear to me because there was a civil procedure, you know, after all that other stuff, where the jury decided that yes, it was the government in concert with the Klan types down there that went ahead and killed Martin Luther King Jr.
Right.
And then, you know, Bobby Kennedy, it's the same way. You know, all these things, it's a terrible tradition to have of a lot of.
But you were in the CIA during this whole time. Did you pick up anything? Did you hear anything?
Well, I didn't hear anything because it's the other CIA that does all this stuff. I mentioned there are two CIAs.
Tell us about that. Fill us in on that again.
Okay.
The two CIAs.
See, Truman was hell-bent and determined that there wouldn't be another Pearl Harbor, right?
Right, okay.
So the war is over, and he wants to have one person responsible, accountable for having all the information on a given subject. So, you know, before Pearl Harbor, there was information with the Navy, with the FBI, with the code breakers, with the broadcast people in Tokyo, with the FBI. And okay, if there were one inbox, okay, where all that stuff came in, it would have been a no-brainer. Where is the Japanese fleet, okay? Mm-hmm. So he was hell-bent and determined. He was not going to let that happen. So he wanted a central intelligence agency where my inbox, for example, would be full of everything having to do with Soviet foreign policy toward the Far East and Vietnam. And that's the way it was. We did get that, okay? The other thing he wanted was an independent agency which would not feel that they had to repeat that the Soviets were 10 feet tall or that the State Department policy is working great. He wanted us to tell it like it is. Now, that's where I worked for almost 29 years, or 27 years, mm-hmm. 3 years in the Army. Now, after the war, the OSS, the Office of Strategic Services, mm-hmm. Incredibly imaginative and brave people, you know, our spies during the war in the European and the Far East, they came mm-hmm. back for Washington, you know, here was it in 1946, 47, and there was great applause and well-deserved applause. Mm-hmm. And then they said, well, you want us to hang around? I mean, you got work for us? I mean, what we do is overthrow governments and we do all kinds of, and the question answered itself. I mean, the Russians were already doing that. They were already taken over Eastern Europe. They were overthrowing governments left and right, the KGB, their mm-hmm. secret police. And so the answer was, yeah, we need you guys. Yes, stay around, okay? Don't go back to academe or to your corporations or to your law firms. Stay around, we need you. The question was, where do you put them? And some idiot, to be mild about the adjective there, said, hey, we're creating this other agency, so the CIA, and they're going to be analysis unit, but they'll have to have their own spies to collect information that's not otherwise available. So there'll be a secret. Yeah, that's a good idea. We'll put all these operations people together with these analysts, and we'll just have one happy secret family. It never worked, Larry, never worked. You can't have the same people running little wars and then saying the truth about what the prospects of the... Take the drones now. You've got John Brennan running the drone thing in Pakistan and Somalia, mm-hmm. Yemen, and God knows where else, okay? And now his analysts from this side of the house go to Congress, and Congress says, are these drones, aren't they creating still more terrorists rather than helping us out? And the analyst knows darn well that that's exactly right. The answer is yes, but his boss is running the drone war. You know, it's an impossible situation. And I served under nine CIA directors. Yeah. Most of them were able to negotiate this thing in a reasonably respectful and integrity way, but not lately. And so that's why you get these two arms of one agency where they're not really compatible. And what happened in Iraq is my former colleagues were suborned into manufacturing evidence for the war. The good news is that after Iraq, the next country in the sights of Bush and Cheney was Iran. And somebody responsible said, you know, we ought to not let Iraq happen again. That was the death knell for the intelligence. Let's get somebody respectable mm-hmm. and honest in to run the Iran estimate. And they did. They had to go to the State Department. The fellow's name was Tom Finger, mm-hmm. okay? He was head of State Department Intelligence. He said, would you do the one on Iran? Because the administration wants to know about nuclear weapons and all that. He said, no, I'm not going to do that. I just went through that rocket thing. No, you're just the guy. He said, well, if you let me take five of my specialists from the State Department, honest specialists, scientists, and I'll do it. And they said, okay, and he did. And so he worked all throughout 2007, okay? Well, Bush and Cheney were very strident in saying Iran is about to get a nuclear weapon. We have to prevent that. Bush said that as late as the last week in October. Mm-hmm. And when the journalist followed up, he said, what do you mean? And Bush said, what do you want? You want World War III? Is that what you want, World War III? Mm-hmm. 2 weeks later, this estimate came out. And I'll quote its main conclusion. Iran stopped working on a nuclear weapon at the end of 2003. And has not resumed work on that weapon, okay? Now, this was said by 16 U.S. intelligence agencies unanimously, and as they put it, with high confidence. Whoa, what happened next? Well, the other element in our government, the Joint Chiefs of Staff, who didn't want any part of a war with Iran, said to the president, you know, this is gonna leak. The Congress has this estimate, it's gonna leak. So you should put out a sanitized version with the main conclusions, and then you can put your own spin on it. how are you going to spin this? It's 180 degrees from what you've been mm-hmm. saying. But the president said, okay, they put it out, and that was the end of the plans for for a war. And it's very clear. Cheney has admitted, yeah, I wanted that to happen. Last thing I'll say about that is that you have to believe me. Look at Bush's memoir. When he addresses this, he must have written this part himself, 471 page or something. He says, this was a eye-popper, this intelligence estimate. It deprived me of the military option, for how could I justify attacking a country that the intelligence community said had no active nuclear weapons program, end quote. Bummer, you know? I mean, you would have thought the reaction would have been, really? Check that out. I call the Israelis. They won't, you know, but instead, it deprived him of the nuclear. So what I'm saying is that there were enough honest analysts in my part of the agency that stopped the war.
You met with Ed Snowden a few months back.
Yeah.
NSA and the connections with the CIA. They working pretty tight with each other?
Yes and no. NSA is...
And how do we stop this? It's like we have created a monster that it seems to be out of control, NSA. I mean, they can make their adjustments. The president can try to affirm all of us. They can stand there and they can just lie. But the evidence that Ed Snowden's been revealing shows that, you know, they can. They can spy on us anytime they want. They can spy on any government they want. You know, as far as privacy in this country, it's a thing of the past.
Well, you know, one of the things that Ed Snowden revealed was that if he had the president's email address, he could get his traffic. And if he had the telephone number of the president, he could do that too, you know, he could snoop on that. And so I made a very simple suggestion the other day to a TV program. I said, you know, what should happen now is the president should get the heads of the NSA under oath there, or put it on the Senate committee, and ask them, have you been or have you ever or are you now reading my emails and listening to my telephone conversations? Yes. We know that they were intercepting Angela Merkel's little handy, they call it, over there, the little cell phone. So who is she talking to? President of the United States. So, you know, they may not have intended to intercept his thing, but, you know, they got his support of the conversation too. So this is one reason I think that he's afraid. They've got the book on the guy. They've got the book on all of us. I mean, you know, they're not... The president gets up and he says, it's only metadata that they're collecting. That's wrong. They're collecting content. And there's proof of that now. Take the Boston bomber, okay? Two bombers, right? One of them had a wife, okay? Now, the FBI has admitted that when they want to find out about the wife and the conversation with the husband, they just went back into the content, okay, not the metadata, but the content of phone calls that had been collected and stored. And so they have the content. And whether the president is not fully briefed on that, or whether he's deliberately misleading the American people, it seems to me that the intelligence agencies are not out of control. They're in control.
In control of what this government is doing.
Yeah.
And that, and they had the power, because you indicated that they had a role in the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr.
Yeah, well, you know, this was mostly Army intelligence and kind of sort of, it was a sui generis type of operation, but they had those white supremacists down there to work with, and I think that was the major story on that one.
And Bobby Kennedy?
Bobby Kennedy is less clear to me, but I haven't really, that's
but
just
John, JFK, you feel pretty strong about?
Yeah, I do. I feel that it's true that the CIA was part of that operation. I think it's true that Obama is fully aware of that. I think it's true that Obama is a little afraid, and I think it's true that he really shouldn't have run for office if he was going to be that afraid.
You are pretty outspoken. You've joined together with other whistleblowers that are quite outspoken. How does your faith give you the courage to continue to be outspoken like this when the President of the United States is afraid to take a stand?
Well, you know, one of my heroes is Dr. King.
Yes.
And in that wonderful piece of American literature, the letter from the Birmingham City Jail, he says lots of wonderful things. But one thing that really sticks in my craw, he says, like a boil that can never be cured as long as it's covered up, but must be opened to the natural medicines of air and light, so too deceit and injustice must be exposed with all the friction that its exposure creates to the light of human conscience and the air of national opinion before it can be cured. So what I see as my role and the role of us veteran intelligence professionals for sanity is to open the boil, let, as Martin Luther King said, all the pus flowing ugliness flow out, and only then can we be able to heal that boil, put dressing on it, rather than cover it up. And so, you know, I think we're getting more and more exposure in alternative media, but I just would want to say, as I always say, that the major nut to crack is what we call the mainstream media. And having been 51 years, later this week will be 51 years in Washington, I've seen a lot of change, but there's one change that dwarfs all the other changes in significance, and that is that we no longer have, in any real sense, a free media, except for stations like your own and people who, you know, are not with the muckety-mucks up there in the evening. Yeah. And unfortunately, most Americans watch the TV in the evening and they think they're getting the news, and they're not getting...
We're one of the last, if not the last, in mid-America, independent television stations. We recently met with a broadcaster, a minority-owned station he had, was one of the last minority owners of, and he sold his station, Channel 46 here. So here we are, locally owned, and sharing this, and on a local basis, what you've said we feel is so important, particularly in relationship to the homeless, the rich, the powerful. And again, this is a city that's totally controlled by Democrats, and yet we see African Americans, 48% of the population, there's not one departmental head that's an African American, not one African American police chief, not one African American fire chief, and yet they want to say they're diversified. It doesn't, the party label doesn't mean a whole lot. It's money today, and we see the Supreme Court just opening it up that rich people are buying all the media, and they're buying the politicians.
Yeah, and it's very much the same in Washington. If I have this on you, I still wear this. I belong to a group that has studied Michelle Alexander's The New Jim Crow book, which shows what's happened, the kind of reversals since the Civil Rights Movement. And, of course, the special thing is the prisons that are full with a disproportionately amount of African Americans and Latino people. So we're hard at working at that, but it's a real tough nut to crack, as you say. And without media, you can get out there and tell the truth. You're really behind the eight ball.
And when money controls it all, the big advertisers, and it looks like, you know, money's controlling politics these days. It'd be easy for people to get discouraged, and that's where our faith is so essential at a time like this.
That's right. You know, we can't give up. What I've observed talking around America is that all too prevalent is the inclination not to try anything unless we have a reasonable expectation of success, right? I mean, nobody likes to be laughed at, you know. But that's not what Jesus was all about, you know? And that's what not Martin Luther King was all about, Dan Berrigan, you know? The good is worth doing because it's good, you know? Results are not unimportant, but they're secondary. And who knows what kinds of seeds you'd be sowing with this program or other programs. And, you know, being fixated on success is not going to do it. We just have to be faithful rather than just fixated on success.
Remember that as we conclude this program, that God has not called us to be successful, but faithful. And those who remain faithful to the end, the same shall be saved. And faith is the evidence of things not yet seen. If you see it and you're guaranteed success, then it's not really faith. And there's often compromise that's involved there. So I'm going to leave you with that particular thought. You may be encountering insurmountable obstacles and odds, but greater is he who's in us than he that's in the world. We must continue to see the hurt, the pain, the need, and stand steadfast at this particular time. There's no time for us to fear. Fear is the opposite of faith. And often faith is moving into uncharted areas, not knowing the end result, except as we're true to what God has called us to do. We're true to the scriptures as he's laid them out before us. And that is, as Jesus said, when I was hungry, did you feed me? Naked, did you clothe me? Sick or in prison, you visit me? Stranger, did you welcome me? As often you've done to the least of these, he said, even so you've done it to me. That's the challenge that exists for each one of us. Be bold, be courageous, and speak up and stand in solidarity with those who feel no one really cares.